Okay, well, the idea is, are we a spirit and a body or just a body? So I started out as an engineer, so I'm very scientific, and I've been through 19 things before I became a Christian. And so I'd just like to present some data. And this video that I'm going to show is just a piece of data. So this will speak for itself.
Can I show it now?
Yeah.
Whilst near-death experiences change lives, they've also given some individuals extraordinary experiences they would never have dreamt of. The most intriguing examples are of blind people becoming sighted for the first time. Vicky Naratuk had been blind from birth.
I've never seen anything, no light, no shadows, no nothing. A lot of people ask if I see black. No, I do not see black. I do not see anything at all. And in my dreams, I don't see any visual impressions. It's just taste, touch, sound, and smell, but no visual impressions of anything.
In her early 20s, Vicky was involved in a serious car accident.
The next thing I recall, I was in Harborview Medical Center and looking down at everything that was happening, and it was frightening because I'm not accustomed to see things visually because I'd never had before, and initially it was pretty scary. And then I finally recognized my wedding ring and my hair, and I thought, is this my body down there? And am I dead or what?
We can't bring her back in the crash room.
They kept saying, we can't bring her back, we can't bring her back. And they were trying to frantically work on this thing that I discovered was my body, and I felt very detached from it. And sort of, so what? And I was thinking, you know, what are these people getting so upset about? Then I thought, I'm out of here. I can't get these people to listen to me. As soon as I thought that, I went up through the ceiling as if it were nothing. And it was wonderful to be out there and be free, not worry about bumping into anything. And I knew where I was going. And I heard this sound of wind chimes. It was the most incredible sound that I could describe. It was from the very lowest to the very highest tones. As I was approaching this area, there were trees and there were birds and quite a few people, but they were all like made out of light. And I could see, and it was incredible, really beautiful. And I was overwhelmed by that experience because I couldn't really imagine what light was like. It's still a very emotional thing when I talk about this because there was a point at which I could bring forth any knowledge I wanted to have, and it was like this place was where all knowledge was. And then I was sent back, and then I went back into my body, and it was excruciatingly painful and very heavy, and I remember feeling very sick.
That's going to okay. Start. Yeah.
Is it over then?
Yeah.
Is that,
okay. So, pretty substantial data there. The fact that she had never seen before, she could never even imagine what sight was like before, and yet when she was out of her body, she could see. Now, the argument that usually goes against that is that, well, it's just some aspect of the brain. No, she was actually seeing. And when she came back, previously, she used to dream, and no vision in the dream. Like she said, she couldn't even concept what black was. But, and then when she came back to her body, same thing. Her dreams never had vision again. So, to me, that's pretty substantial data. Well, I mean, but that's not the only one. If you look at the handout that I gave, there's a book called Mindsight, And these are by objective scientists. My insights by Dr. Kenneth Green, who's professor emeritus of psychology at the University of Connecticut. And then there's evidence of the afterlife by Dr. Jeffrey Long of over 1,600 out-of-body experiences and near-death experiences. So the data seems to say that we are a spirit. We're something different than our body. There's something that left her body. There's something that that is not a part of the brain. As a matter of fact, people tend to take the brain-only thing. Is if you think about, well, where's our central focus? You know, what are we looking from? And people would say, well, it's from behind your eyes, and that's where the brain is. But I've had an out-of-body experience, and I can say that my locus did shift to the ceiling and then to the floor. The place from where I looked from was not behind here anymore. I was looking down at my body, and then I was looking up at my body. So the fact that the focus, the central place from where we look from, is not the body, is not the brain, is proven by that, just like what she said, and over 1,600 experiences too that are chronicled in this book. You know, like the one thing that the video that you said to watch from the Yale guy, it's dualism versus physicalism, and dualism is that we're a body and a soul, and physicalism is just a body. Well, I would add a third one, and that would be a spirit. And my definition of a spirit is, it's an observer experiencer with limited free will. In other words, it's us. We are the spirit. And we can observe and we can experience, but not just a soul. As a matter of fact, the Bible breaks down what a soul is. And basically a soul, animals have souls too. And it's just it's the animating thing within this physical thing. Within an animal, it's the animating thing that God breathed into to make it operate on its own. I mean, we don't circulate our blood, we don't breathe our breathing, we don't do a whole lot of stuff, but it happens automatically. So the body does have a soul, and that's the animating factor. Well, the spirit part is just us who's going along for the ride temporarily in this lifetime. And that the proof of that is what you just saw, the many case histories, my personal experience, and let's see. There's a difference, though. Now, so, what are the attributes of a spirit? You know, I say this is physics, and there's something called spirics. I call it spirics. In other words, it's a different set of rules as to how things operate. And what she said, and what a lot of people say, and what I experienced also when I was just in the spirit and stopped this linear, brain thinking. Is that you do see things. You're able to access a lot of knowledge at one time. You're able to see, and it just, you just know, you know. And so I did a form of a prayer, which is in Psalm 4:4, which says, "Ponder your hearts on your bed and be silent." And I did that. I call it, I try to make it scientific, and I call it ISO, which is internal silent observation. In other words, it's just going inside and just looking. What's going on there? How does that all work in there? You know, and you see thoughts up here, a mind, and you see a heart down here with emotions, and then you see the sixth sense, which you become really aware of when you kind of, you know, quiet all this down. So. So when you're in that state.
30 seconds.
Okay. When you're in that state, by the way, then you get the rest of what I'm saying on this paper that I handed out. When you're in that state, you do see things. I mean, like you're in there, and then you say, "My mate," and it hits you, and all of a sudden you don't have this evaluative thing that comes and says, "Oh no, it's this way, and they're that way, and you know, or life is this way, and the planet is that way." It's just you see it for what it is. And for who they are, it's a great thing. I highly recommend it.
Fine.
Okay.
right, and just to give you some more introductory comments, after I have my 10 minutes, we're going to have a 10-minute dialogue where I'm going to speak for 5 minutes, and then I'll ask primarily drive the questions to Dennis for 5 minutes, and then he can have 5 minutes to primarily drive some questions to me. And then we're going to have an audience Q&A, and that'll be for quite some time, so you guys will have a good chance to ask a question. Okay, so if I can get 10 minutes, ready? Okay. So my beliefs determine how I interpret the world. And I'm a secular humanist. This is my definition of secular humanism. I like it because it's short and has a lot of power-packed words in it. It's a naturalistic belief system that promotes critical thinking and morality by using modern science and reason. And so I want you to even hold me to account when I give my presentation to see if I'm using critical thinking and modern science and reason. Because if I am saying something illogical, that's something I'm really concerned about, because I want to follow the truth, and I depend on critical thinking and modern science and reason to get me there. Critical thinking is not any good by itself. You have to actually have a body of knowledge also, so the science is important. But if you just had the science without the critical thinking, that wouldn't help you either. So you need both the science, knowledge base, plus the critical thinking to operate on that data. So we all agree we have 5 senses. This is the hearing, sight, touch, smell, and taste. These are basically sensors. We have, you know, like if we were a robot, the robot has a brain, and it has sensors, and that's how it knows the world, by sensing it in different ways, and the brain computes what to do based on those senses. So in the same way, we have these sensors, and these are the sensors we have. So there's a question, is there a sixth sense? And it really gets down to the mind. And the question is, from the highest level, is it totally natural, is it partly supernatural, or totally supernatural? And the two extreme positions, and there's lots of in between, are dualism and monism. Dualism says there's two different parts of that makes you you. There's a physical part, and there's a supernatural, spiritual part, and these two combine to make the person that you are. Monism says there's only the physical part, basically. There is no supernatural or spiritual part. So is there any good evidence for a soul and or spirit? I didn't say is there any evidence, I said is there any good evidence. You know, when you go to a court, you can give all kinds of evidence, and you need to evaluate whether it's good evidence or not. Is it applicable? Anybody can say here's some evidence, but does it matter? And I would say no, there is no good evidence for a soul. And I want to talk about two Christian apologists. I think the best Christian apologist is, an apologist is a person who defends the faith. He's a very public person. His name is William Lane Craig. He debates all the high-level atheists. And he basically, they had this question of, you know, how do you deal with modern science? Because modern science is really indicating now that there is no spiritual part of the mind. This has flip-flopped in the last 50 years or so. It used to be that everybody believed, of course, there was a spiritual part of the mind. Now most of the people in science say, of course not, it's all kind of physical based. So William Lane Craig basically answered this question by having a guest writer who is a neurologist, I believe, or somebody in the sciences, and they basically said, yes, you know, we admit that science has figured out a lot about the brain, like which part of the brain does what. You know, this is something the ancients didn't know, and like Descartes didn't know about this, and he's one of the famous philosophers from way back. And they said, but even though we know the brain controls a lot, it doesn't necessarily mean there is no spirituality. And he says, let me give you an example. Suppose an alien came down and said, hey, what's this thing? And you say it's a TV, and he says, okay, don't tell me, I'm going to figure out how it works. And so he messes around with it, disconnects a wire and sees that there's no red, and then he disconnects another wire and sees that there's no blue, you know, colors, and disconnects another one, sees the speaker doesn't work. So he says, okay, this is a box that basically makes pictures. And see, what he would be missing there is he doesn't know that there's an antenna that's picking up a wave, you know, over the air. So that's one of the philosophical arguments he's given to say, like, see, even though the box could be probed and we see how it makes these pictures, it doesn't mean there's nothing else going on beyond that. So I would say, well, the flaw with that example is that if this person really did study this TV, they would find out some things like there's channels. Okay, well, the channel just might be different programs, but there's also an antenna. What does this antenna do? Let's take it off. Let's enhance it. So they would start to also figure out there's a part to it, the antenna. And so as you know, people have probed the brain, of course, they haven't seen any kind of spiritual antenna or anything like that. So anyway, that was their main thrust for a philosophical argument. And I think that was their weak spot. Greg Kukul, I'm not sure if it's Kukul or Kokul. One of you guys will probably know. Both of these people are on like iTunes, they have ministries. He gave an example that basically said, you know, we know that in our body, all our cells are regenerating all the time. So after 7 years, you're a totally different person. Well, turns out we just found out before this event that was a scientific myth. There is a lot of, most of our cells do change over time, but some of them don't. But anyway, the point was is that since our body is constantly replenishing ourselves, but you are the same you through all these years, obviously that other part of you transcends the physical. That's the supernatural part of you. That's the you that's always been around or whatever. And so I think the obvious flaw with that is that we are not the same. When we're an infant, you know, our brains are, we have an infantile brain, so we act like infants, you know. And we're adults, we act like adults. We have an adult brain. And then if we live old enough, we go into dementia, and our brain goes. So I'll talk more about that later. So anyway, my argument to theirs is that it was a poor example that, somehow we stay the same. We don't stay the same. We're constantly evolving. Everything is moving. And also about the TV, I wanted to say, if the alien who inspected the TV had the attitude of like, well, I don't care about science, obviously this TV works by magic. That's the best way to explain that. See, I think that's actually the best analogy for why religion would say, oh, well, the mind, yeah, we can't comprehend that. It's so complex. It's got to be magic. It's got to be a God to do that. So I would say that example could actually be turned around to show that a non-thinking person would tend to go for some kind of magical thinking on that. So here's some typical problems when you say there's such a thing as a soul. Where do they come from? How does God make a soul? Does he give out a part of himself because he's eternally existing and says, okay, here's this? Well, I don't think Christians would say they're a part of God. They think they're somehow created. So how does God create soul stuff? You know, what does he make that from? Also, when God gives out the soul to people, this first word, it's pronounced chimera. Chimera is when an egg is fertilized, it's possible that the woman could actually have two eggs fertilized. And as it's developing in the womb, at some point they can join together and create one person. It's very rare, but it happens. And this is sometimes when people have different eye colors, for example, that explains what happened. So then the question is, well, you know, if the soul was given at conception, does that mean that each one was given half a soul so they combined to have one soul? Or did somebody get their soul wiped out when they joined, or how'd that work? And identical twins is the case where an egg is fertilized and it's developing, and sometime in its development, it actually breaks into two complete different people. So in that case, it's the opposite, where it's like, well, now if these are two people and each have a soul, does that mean that initially they were given, when it was one thing, did it have two souls and then each one took a soul? Or, you know, how did that split out? And one time there was a priest in the audience one time, and I heard him say that, well, you know, some people think we're pro-life because we think the soul is given at conception, but it's not necessarily church doctrine. We just believe life is sacred. So even the Catholic Church is not going to say that, oh, the soul is given at conception, because of these kind of problems here. Another one is like, what would the afterlife be like if for aborted babies? Some people think there's up to 70% natural miscarriage. A lot of times women don't even know they were pregnant. And they think all pregnancies, probably 70%, end in miscarriage. What about those who are mentally retarded? You know, sometimes people say, like, oh, that's not the real them. Their real soul is somewhere else. When they get to heaven, they'll be full or something. But no, that's them. That's reality. And when that person you see with dementia, that's really them at that point. It's not like the sickness is masking the real them. That is them at that point. And it's a delusion to think like, oh, well, that's not the real them. The real them was 20 years ago. No, that was actually a different them at a different point in time. And then also you have to think about soul and spirit, you know, how's it change for chimps? For different animals, you know, if you say animals have souls and spirits, well, what about bacteria, viruses, plants, you know? There's all kinds of weird creatures out there, the more you study it. So we used to think that an angry God caused lightning and thunder until we discovered it was because of electrical differences. Okay, and we used to think that an angry God caused earthquakes and tsunamis until we learned about plate tectonics. So now I think we used to think that the mind had a supernatural aspect to it until the field of neurology matured. And there are people I've heard, you know, leaving the faith over this aspect. And I think it's really important to learn by looking at the animals, because there's so much we can learn about them from evolution, how their brain, you can see how their brain changes and those kind of things. So anyway, that's it for my time. Thank you very much. And we can go over any of these slides if you have more questions.
Should I take 5 minutes then?
Yeah.
Okay. You covered a lot of ground there.
So let's see if the, so Rachel, can you?
Okay.
Okay, you covered a lot of ground, and but let me before I address some of your points, let me present another point. Okay, so the idea is: are we a brain? Is our mind just a function of the brain or not? I was lucky to have this experience where I poured some lye down a drain in the basement, and there was no ventilation, so I literally lost my mind for a while there, but I didn't lose my spirit. I was able to observe the whole thing happening. My mind was not functioning right. It was like my thoughts were echoing, and I thought I was feeling something or thinking something, and I started laughing about it. It was kind of a weird experience in the hospital regarding it. But the entire time, my spirit was observing it. It's like nothing had changed in my spirit. So, and there have been a lot of studies like that too, people with dementia and stuff. You know, they get frustrated because they're observing their body not working right. So yeah, the mind is a function of the brain, but there's a spiritual mind too. And that's what she was talking about. That's the thing I was saying, that you can absorb a lot of knowledge. So you said here, is there any good evidence for a soul and her spirit? What was that I just played? Why wasn't that? Well, you can answer that. Why wasn't that good
evidence?
Well,
we're supposed to have an interchange here.
Oh, okay. Okay, so why wasn't that good evidence?
Well, I would say that's anecdotal evidence. For example, you know, somebody could say, Joseph Smith said he saw God the Father in person, but you don't accept that because...
No, I'm talking about her now. And I'm talking about the many studies that have come, that are in these books. Scientific studies, objective, not religious people.
Right. From my understanding, there's not one scientific study that has proven anything. For example, they actually have scientific studies for out-of-body experiences, and they have not found one yet. They have very clever tests they have set up. All this is based on anecdotal evidence. They have people saying, this is what I saw.
Well, that's true. But if you say there's no oil in certain parts of Colorado, does that mean there's no oil in Colorado at all? See, it's just those specific studies didn't yield that kind of a proof, what you were talking about. You described this to me before. They put hid something and asked the out-of-body person to go tell what it was. On the other hand, there are a lot of people who have found oil in parts of Colorado, and in this sense, the analogy would say that there are a lot of studies where people have had out-of-body experiences, like that book you were mentioning earlier, where they have been able to access and tell exactly what certain conversations were in other places than where their body was, that they had no privy to.
Well, I would say those are not scientific studies or anecdotal stories that people told. It's not science where things are under control and they're measured objectively and people can reproduce the measurements. They're just stories.
So that was just a story?
Yes. Just like Joseph Smith's story or
the fact that she had vision and she never had vision before. Doesn't that say something to you?
I don't know all the details on that, but I mean, religious stories, there's no end to it. The Hindus have them, everybody has them. Joseph Smith,
I'm speaking scientifically now. She said that she gained vision out of her body.
Yeah.
And there are a lot of people who would say that, who were blind from birth, who never had any concept of black, she said, or light.
Yeah, but see what you're saying? Everything you're saying is, she said. I mean, a Mormon could say the same thing about Joseph Smith said this. Why are you putting all your evidence in somebody's testimony? You can't validate it.
Well, I've had out-of-body experience myself, so I don't have to go like that. I know it for a fact. So, just from personal experience.
Well, some people also have, like Native American Indians, they think like the trees or the rocks have spirits, and they can say they have a relationship with that thing, and They feel that. So how could you argue that that tree does not have a spirit?
It doesn't have a spirit. It might have a soul. The Bible doesn't address that. It says animals have souls. And I would think that anything that is self-propelling, this doesn't have a soul here, because it's not self-propelling. But anything that's self-propelling,
the atoms are moving.
Sure.
Well, yeah. I mean, there is a
electrons. Spirit. I mean.
That's right. Well, yeah, and you can say that for the entire universe,
30 seconds.
Which is emotion.
Pardon? 30 seconds.
For.
So 5 minutes is up.
Well, actually, we're going 10 minutes now.
Well, no, 5 minutes for you, and then 5 minutes for me to ask you questions. You're supposed to ask me 5 questions.
Oh, okay.
And I ask
you. Okay. Oh, well. Too late now. Okay. Well, so go ahead. Well, 30 seconds. I'm just as scientific and objective as what you're describing here as a secular humanist. You know, I want evidence, and I'm in critical thinking, and I'm not into really believing or faith without having proof. That's why I wrote that book, The Proof.
Okay. All right, so you can put me on for 5 minutes now.
Okay.
Just even from a theological standpoint, I think there's a big problem here. I have a seminary degree, a master's in ministry degree, and you said, for example, you're working with Drano or some chemical and you're out of your mind, but your spirit was there. For one thing, you're talking about, like, as if you know what a spirit is, you can define it. Now, in my favorite systematic theology textbook, it was called Christian Theology by Millard Erickson. He talks about all the different definitions of what the soul and the spirit are, and then he says, this is my explanation. Now, the truth is, the Bible talks about the soul and the spirit sometimes as a synonym, like the same thing, and sometimes like they're different things. Yeah. It talks about both of them. So to pretend like it only talks about one of them, to me, shows that you're ignoring Bible verses that say they're the same,
no,
or indicate that they're the same.
Hebrews 4:12, which is in the handout, says that soul and spirit are two different things.
Yeah, I know.
And the Bible, in the Old Testament and the New Testament, has different words for soul and spirit.
I can give you a scripture where they indicate that they're the same, too, if you want to hear some. Okay, let me see if I can find it. Okay. Job 7:11, therefore I will not keep silent. I will speak out in the anguish of my spirit. I will complain in the bitterness of my soul. Now, the argument is that when it's like, what is a spirit? Well, here it's indicating that there's the anguish of a spirit and a bitterness of the soul. Anguish and bitterness are on the same level. So that means spirit and soul are on the same level and not like two different things.
Well, no, you can't take that leap. They can both have anguish and bitterness.
But here's another one, Isaiah 26:9. My soul yearns for you in the night. In the morning, my spirit longs for you. So here, the soul yearns for him in the night. And in the morning, it longs for God.
Yeah. So
it's like, there are verses, and there's a lot of cases like that. I mean, that's just two examples.
Well, so. Neither of them work, though.
Okay. Let me bring up a different one, too. Let's see. Well, what do you think about... I guess I'm just thinking that why... Well, let's talk about confirmation bias. Confirmation bias is like, for example, you believe this woman because it's what you want to hear, but Joseph Smith says, I saw God the Father in person, but you say, no, that can't be true because God wouldn't do that. Why would you believe, why don't you believe Joseph Smith for his testimony?
I don't believe anybody. My basis for what I accept as fact is it's in the Bible. I accept the Bible as an inerrant book of facts. Now, how did I come to that? I came to that as an engineer. I had to prove it.
But this woman was not in the Bible, though. We're talking about you believe her, but not the testimony of Joseph Smith.
She's just validating what's in the Bible. Joseph Smith isn't.
He says he does.
Well, it doesn't matter. See, now you want me to accept what he says. No. I mean, I accept the Bible first, see, and then anything outside of the Bible that confirms it, you know, well, then I'll accept that. And I don't see why she would lie. She seemed very sincere. But I'm not basing my belief that we have a spirit, that we are a spirit, on what she said, or what anybody says, really. It's that, is the Bible true or not? And that can be that could be examined, and then I've done that, and I've proven that it is.
I've been in a church setting before where somebody said, "Oh, I experienced," and then later on, I heard the pastor give it from the pulpit, and he totally revamped the story. And for me, I thought it was a different story, but then I realized it wasn't the same story. I've had actually profound dreams myself that were partly goofy, and if I wanted to tell somebody else the cleaned up version, you know, they wouldn't have known the goofy part. So I'm wondering her story, how goofy, there's probably dogs barking and UFOs and everything else, but she says, "Oh, I'm just going to tell you this part." How do you know she's not cleaning it up?
Okay, in this book, Evidence of the Afterlife, there's over 1,600 case studies all over the world, different religions, different cultures, different nationalities, and they all have similar things, you know, the tunnel, the light, all that, the access to a lot of knowledge at one time.
Right, but those are just testimonies.
Yeah, but they're all uniform. Over 1,600 of them are uniform.
They're not, I wouldn't say they're uniform. Sometimes they see a light, sometimes people see dread.
Yeah, they go to hell, yeah. They see hell, they see hell.
One woman wrote a book about her trip to heaven, and then she later on wrote a book about her trip to hell, you know, you heard about her.
Yeah, there's a number of those too. Well, I mean, you talk about multiverses.
Okay. So now we're going to open up to the audience for Q&A. So,
the story of the blind woman. She was blind from birth. So what were her reference points for saying these were people or this was light or this was that? She has no reference point.
Exactly.
How do you know what she saw?
Exactly.
How does she know what she saw?
Exactly. You're proving the point.
No, I'm not. I'm proving that she was just telling a story. She has no...
She had no way of knowing what light or color or anything that was, like that was, previously to the experience. After the experience, she was able to describe it for the first time. See, that to me gives a lot of credibility to her story.
Well, of course, most people would say it's hallucinations.
Well, I mean, we got to have a facility to hallucinate with, which she didn't have previously.
So how did she know she saw people?
Do we have to raise our hands?
Yeah, just a minute. Let him...
Well, yeah, the way that I look at it, I mean, I give three examples in my book of how things can exist without us being able to know about it. And I say, well, can a tree know about comedy? No, but comedy does exist, see. Can a blind person know about color? No, but color does exist, see. So things, well, she was, you know, exposed to something for the first time after her experience. And was able to tell it. Like, if a tree's told you a joke, you know.
No, but she described people. How did she know she saw people? She's never seen people before.
Well, she knows about people. I mean, that, I don't know.
Well, but she doesn't know what they look like. So how can she say, "I saw people"?
Well,
she knows
described
what she
them.
Looks like.
She described them.
How can she know what she looks like?
Because
she's
she felt herself. She knows people have two arms and two legs.
Well, okay. You know the story about someone touching an elephant. Just touching the trunk and thinking it's a tree or something.
Yeah. Okay, so yeah, we understand the question, and I guess it's something we'll have to talk about more about. Okay, there was a question way back there. Okay.
Yeah, my point was, the only strange thing about this woman's story is the fact that she recognized things, right? Older, she had been blind all her life. Because there's nothing strange about having a sense of trying. We all do that in our dreams, right? So the mind can create all kinds of things, but you have to create it from something that is known, right? And this woman had lived for maybe, well, I don't know how old she was when she had the accident, probably 30, 40 years old. She must have had, through communication, a pretty clear picture of what the world looks like. She recognized the ring, and somebody must have told her that this is a golden ring your husband gave you, and it has such and such a pearl, and so on and so on. So she must have had an image of that in her head already.
Well, no,
it's not a movie. The imagery as it's described is far from clear. It's full of lights and stuff like that, which you could expect if somebody has to create images based on what people have told them.
Yeah, right.
Must be a lot of diffuse.
But nobody could explain to her what color was. And see, she was able to describe color after her experience. She said, I mean, previously, she didn't even know what black was. People had asked her, like she said in the video, "Do you see black?" And she goes, "No, I see nothing." And then, after the experience, she knew what black and light was and color.
Yeah, she may have known from talking to people that apples are green and grass is green. And,
well, she just said she didn't.
So I mean, all these associations could be latent in her brain. That's what I'm saying. doesn't mean that there's a supernatural and only a supernatural explanation.
I think what you have to do is you have to take all the data at one time. See, I mean, there's these two books, which have a lot of case histories. I mean, I have personal experiences with it. And there's, you know, like people describing things that they couldn't have known previously. And there's a lot of case histories of that. So you just can't wipe it off, you know, with that explanation.
Okay.
Well, I was just going to say that, you know, there's still an awful lot about the brain that they don't know, you know, really, you know, conclusively about. And there could be in some part of the brain, you know, you have your DNA is from your mother and father, you know. There could be somehow some sort of a vestigial something that, you know, that has experiences of those people, you know, and from far beyond.
So you're saying that those things were triggered, what about the experience, but not accessed previously?
Exactly, because of some traumatic experience, some trauma to her brain, and that's what happened. And it could be something along those lines. We just don't know. But to say that because we don't know, it has to be this. That's kind of
what you're saying, though.
No,
saying.
I'm not saying that it has to be that.
No, you're saying
I'm saying that it could be that.
Yeah.
But people saying that it has to be this.
Well, that's why we look at the whole body of data. I mean, one piece of data here in support of the spirit and soul idea is I've written a book called The Proof that God Exists in the Bible is True. Now, you know, Jesus did a lot of supernatural miracles. There have been a lot of miracles since then. There's a lot of proofs that the Bible is true. So, I mean, I see it as God gave us this book to kind of tell us what's going on here. I mean, we just appeared on this planet. We're going to have to leave at some point. We're in this giant universe. What's that all about? Well, if there's a loving God, he'd want to let us know what it's about and what his project is here. And so, therefore, I prove that book as being true, the Bible. And so that's just another source of data.
I think one of your points is, too, is that there could be like a residual energy from previous people that lived or something like that.
Or memories that are, you know, in some part of the DNA that is transferred.
But that's speculation.
You know, exactly. It's all speculation. Yeah, but so is a soul.
See, now, I would say from my aspect, the mind simply emerges from the brain. When you shut the brain down, the mind goes. There's nothing residual, nothing to pass on through DNA or whatever. Everything emerges from the brain. And, you know, for example, if somebody says, well, yeah, there's ghosts, they're on TV, don't you see the ghost hunters on TV? I think none of that stuff has been scientifically proven. It's
right.
All, they got goosebumps on the back of their head, and ooh, there's spooky music in the background, turn the lights off. You know, so, I would say there is no scientific evidence, and I would question anything like this. And I don't think, testimony is scientific evidence. It is not scientific evidence.
No.
So,
well, it's a personal thing then. I mean, I have a lot of evidence, personal experience, myself, for myself, and I know it's
true. But it's not scientific, though. It's not scientific.
Well, if the scientific part would be if a lot of people, say if people saw a murder, and a whole bunch of people had abhorrence to that and anger to that. Well, it's scientific if you can say that uniformly a lot of people had the same reaction. See, so that's scientific.
I think it's just, I mean, that's just eyewitness testimony, and you know, you have to in court a lot.
No, the fact that some people weren't laughing and some people weren't making a shrine, and no, they all had the same experience, the same reaction pretty much. That's scientific, that innate in the being is a reaction to murder. That's bad.
Okay, question way back there.
Can I just for both of you guys or just one?
Just do one first because we have other people that want to ask questions.
Okay, well, Bernie, I think you guys were just addressing this, but you know, scientific evidence requires it being repeatable. So you're sort of discounting, and I'm not saying he's made his case at all. Whether he has or not is a separate question. You're essentially making it impossible for me to state to you that I drove here tonight because it's not a repeatable fact. And therefore, in your mind, it's not useful evidence or acceptable evidence. So anything that's not repeatable, you're going to put out of court. It's not being acceptable. So these things are not repeatable. There's no way you're what you're asking for could not be given. It's impossible.
Okay. Well, I would say I'm not demanding that it has to be repeatable. For example, evolution is not repeatable. But we can study DNA, for example, and see the footprints through the genome of that. That's why I'm convinced it happened. Basically, it comes down to inductive and deductive reasoning. This, therefore this. But Dennis's evidence is all testimony. It's testimony only. And the testimonies, I think when you analyze it, they're a little bit over the map. They're probably copied from each other. There's certain memes out there. Like when people see UFOs, they all kind of report the same kind of thing. Maybe, you know, at first the UFOs look a little bit different, but then after 20 years, they all kind of say the same thing. Yeah, it's a saucer. They're grays, or they're tall. They got big eyes. You know, pretty soon they all converge on the same fantasy. So
it doesn't give you, testimony doesn't give you necessary truth, but that still doesn't mean that it's not valid. You know, that's still not an argument against
anecdotal,
therefore not true.
Well, I would say
that doesn't follow.
It could be valid, but I'm just saying it's not scientific evidence. And Dennis says this is scientific evidence for this, and it's not. It's anecdotal evidence. That's all I'm saying. You have to give it the weight it's worth, and it's not much if it's anecdotal. Otherwise, you'd be believing Joseph Smith, the Hindus, everybody that has a religious experience, and they have contradictory messages. God tells them to do different things. Thank you.
Time for what?
Oh, that's, yeah.
I thought this was the audience section. I mean, it's so
yeah, but I don't want to dominate it. So we could give other people a chance to talk to.
Okay, so, I just want to say one thing, though, in regards to that. See, basically, if you don't accept testimonies or uniform experiences with human beings, you've just wiped out the science of psychology and sociology and anthropology. See, there are things that can be observed as far as like what's the experience and reaction within human beings. I think that is scientific if it's uniform.
But I would say you're selective of what you accept. You accept things that back up the Bible, but not Joseph Smith or
if it's Joseph Smith, that's one person. That's not a repeatable thing.
Question?
Just basically in your thought processes and everything, you're heavily using and relying on the scientific method, but there are many things that exist that really can't be proven by the scientific method. I mean, if you were to use concepts like love or hate or different things, I mean, are you just going to just see evidence of what that is? You know, there's no real proof. You can't prove everything by the scientific method.
Mm-hmm. I agree. Yeah, I'm not saying the scientific method only either. I want to make a point about critical thinking and inductive and deductive reasoning.
Right.
But what I'm talking against is anecdotal evidence where somebody says, I have a story or God told me something.
Right.
I don't care if 10 people said God told them the same thing.
But if 10,000 or 10 million, somewhere along the lines, anecdotal evidence turns into... it's repeatable because 1,600 people repeated the same thing. So somewhere along the lines, anecdotal turns into evidence.
Well, it would be nice if they all said the same thing, but when you have one editor putting it together and who knows what they said, you know, they have their own agenda.
You're begging the question, though. You're dismissing it because you disagree with it on philosophical grounds. You dismiss any possibility of the supernatural. Therefore, it doesn't matter if every person on the planet besides you came up and had this testimony, you would dismiss it because you reject the supernatural. So it's you're making a philosophical begging of the question when you dismiss the evidence.
Well, I'm saying the premise is inaccurate to say there's all these people that have an agreement over a testimony. I'm not saying, I don't think that's the case. I think that's a wrong statement to make. I disagree.
If they did, you would still reject it.
Well, even if, yeah, well, even but did, if we saw flying reindeer.
Did you read the book? Did you read the book?
And
did you hear of the 1,600 people that did have similar stories?
Many years ago, I read that book, Life After Life, and all the testimonies about it.
So you have to either accept that they had similar stories, or you have to come up with a reason, which you're doing, why they didn't. And somewhere along the lines, it's just as valid to say they had similar reasons or they had similar stories because it was real as it is to say they had similar stories because the editor made it that way.
Right. And you know, here's the bottom line. We got one lifetime to play this game. You know, we just appeared on this planet. We're going to be forced to be removed from this planet at some point. But there's a giant universe out there, and we could play this game, you know, discounting and counting certain testimonies for one lifetime. But then, you know, what reality is going to set in? It's going to hit us in the face after we die. So therefore, it's good if we've made a good decision. And there's a lot of evidence, you know, for the fact that there is a God and that the Bible is true.
Okay, over there.
I just wanted to make a short statement about that, about this issue, and that is, I believe you said something like the experiences that people report prove that there's a supernatural something, right?
Well, no, that's just one little thing.
That's not what you said?
Yeah, I mean, that's one little thing. That's one little piece of data. You know, but
Excuse me?
That's just one little piece of data as to whether, I mean, there's okay. a lot of data from a lot okay. of different angles.
If I'm not mistaken, there have been experiments where people have had similar experiences to the one that you're describing by having certain parts of their brain stimulated. Mm-hmm. So that doesn't really... That wouldn't be considered a supernatural experience, right?
No, that's true. You're absolutely right. But what about these out-of-body experiences where people go and they hear conversations in places that they did, that there's no way that they could have known what they were, and then they come back and recount them to the people who said them, and there's a lot of experiences like
there's
that.
There's a lot of testimony by people who claim to have. Recalled something from a past life. Do you believe that that's true?
I've been through that. I mean, I've been through. Like I said, I went through 19 different things before I became a Christian, and I was in a couple of things that try to prod you into remembering your past life. And the person who was prodding you was really prodding you, like, oh, did you see this? You know, and they were pushing.
I'm talking about people, kids in India, for example,
Why just in India?
One of them says because they, you know, reincarnation is accepted over there as a part of just like the supernatural God thing is a part of this culture, and everybody, you know, so it affects people's viewpoints. So I'm saying that in this particular area of reincarnation, there's been kids who have their stories that they have recalled incidents in places in faraway villages. And they take them over there, and sure enough, there's those things. And to me, those are just as valid as the things that you're describing.
Yeah, I can't discount that. I can be in agree you just said.
You can't discount it?
No, I mean, if that's true, what he just said, you know, well, there's something going on there.
That means reincarnation is true, and you don't believe that.
Well, no, see, the thing is that the Bible says, it's appointed unto man but to die once, and then the judgment. So, I do have a lot of data backing up the Bible. So, I'd have to, you know, it's a testimony.
Okay, Dave, I think, had a question. We have a couple more. Yeah, Dave.
1,600 anecdotes, trivial, nothing. 7 billion people on this planet. Can only produce 1,600 story? Nothing.
No, only 1,600 out-of-body experiences.
Okay, out-of-body experiences.
Out of 7 billion people,
by the way,
that's
like
a lot.
How is that different from a particularly vivid dream? Even if there are millions of people who believe something, like the gentleman in the first row said, suppose millions of people believe a story, doesn't that make it quite possibly true?
No,
there are millions of people who believe that Noah got two of every animal on his ark.
But you're talking about belief. These are people who actually went other places and heard conversations and came back and retold. That's different altogether.
They said they heard other conversations. There are also hundreds and hundreds of people who say they were abducted by aliens who came down in spaceships. Do you accept those stories?
Well, if they're only in farms in Kansas, I don't know. It seems kind of dumb. You know. It's got to be reproducible.
For Dennis,
okay.
beyond the accumulation of personal testimony and your personal conviction that the Bible is true, is there any other evidence that you refer to?
Oh, yeah, as far as the Bible being true?
No, not as far as the Bible being true. Beyond your conviction that the Bible is true and and the accumulation of anecdotal stories, is there any science beyond that that you refer to?
Absolutely.
So you're asking for what scientific evidence?
What scientific evidence beyond personal testimonies and his personal belief that the Bible is true?
There it
now,
is.
Now, I'm not arguing about whether the Bible is true. I'm beyond your belief that the Bible is true.
I don't have a belief.
Oh, okay, well then there's...
There's proof. I have proof.
So that's... But beyond... Okay, beyond...
Can you give me one, like, what's
let me
what's
let me phrase it a different way.
Okay.
Just for argument's sake, beyond your knowledge that the Bible is true and personal testimonies, is there any science beyond that?
No, there's no testimonies in here. It's all science.
I'm accepting for argument's sake that the Bible's true. Okay.
Okay.
Beyond the Bible being true and personal testimonies, an accumulation of testimonies, is there science beyond that?
So, like, what example for science can you give? Like, what's the best science for anything supernatural, or what do you want?
Yeah,
for?
Like, but for a supernatural soul that exists beyond our physical death, just for argument's sake, I'll accept. Okay, the Bible's true. Beyond the Bible, true, and the personal testimonies, what science beyond that?
Okay, I get what you're saying.
Yeah. And maybe by science,
and that's what this book is filled with that.
For this personal, for this question, I'm not challenging that belief. I'm just saying beyond that belief.
Yeah, and that's what I'm saying. This book has just what you just asked for.
Okay, can you give an example?
Give us an example, please.
Okay, scientific proof of God. You want me to
No, scientific proof of an afterlife. A soul, our soul, that exists after our body dies.
Oh, okay, I see what you're saying now. So, in other words, by doing it through the Bible, that's circumstantial evidence. You want direct proof.
I want to know if you have anything more than the Bible saying it and personal testimonies.
Probably something objective is what you're asking
for. Yeah, anything objective and measurable.
Or somebody else can say
it. Beyond the Bible saying,
right.
Beyond personal testimonies, is there anything else?
Right, I don't think that exists, and I think there's a good reason for that. And the reason is that, you know, if you were going to marry somebody, you'd want them to love you, right? And so God has set it up so that we fall in love with His way of doing things. We're on this planet, we see how things work, how people do things, we're not happy about it, we think there's got to be something better. Then we come across what God says, the Bible, and through our hearts, and we say, that's beautiful. I want to be a part of that, see? And that's why God does, I mean, if God wanted to just come out of the sky and say, boo, He'd have a bunch of people would say, oh yeah, 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 okay. You know, but it's okay. Is that acceptable for somebody who wants to love
religion? Engineered by God to exercise our faith.
Pardon?
So the mystery is purposely engineered by God so we can exercise our faith and have better faith or pure love. Or...
So that we can see it. So it recognize what's going on in our heart. See, the thing is we have to recognize that we have this thing here called a heart, and we have to deal with it. So we want to come in harmony with it. We all want it to give us good feelings and not bad feelings. So then we would see how that works. And when we follow the Bible and follow God the way He wants to be followed, He gives us good feelings and not bad feelings.
Okay, I just want to make a comment too. When I was a Christian, I believed, I was an evangelist and apologist, and I believed that there was scientific evidence for God. But now I'm convinced there is no evidence for God that's objective like that. So
what happened to the evidence that you believed then?
Basically, it comes down to being scientifically ignorant. I learn more science and learn more about critical thinking, and it evaporates. And basically, all the evidence for God turned out to be God of the gaps. How does this happen? We don't know. Therefore, it's evidence for God.
But
not
see, now,
really.
Now you have evolution of the gaps. But, you know, I mean, Louis Pasteur said this, a little bit of science averts us from God. A lot of it brings us back to Him. See? So you still have to go one more step.
Okay. Question there?
So I have a question for you, Mr. Dehler here. So you presented reasons why the Christian view in the spirit is not the case, but haven't presented any good, in your view, what you would call good evidence why your view is correct.
Yeah, so basically I would just say because of what neurology has accomplished in like maybe the last 20 years or so, they've poked and prodded the brain, they found out what parts of the brain do what, and this is all kind of recent knowledge. This is something that ancient philosophers didn't have. And it kind of blows a lot of their arguments out of the water.
How?
Because they didn't even know things like, now we studied animals, we see how morality actually, there's a semblance of morality in the animals even. We see how these things, you know, with our more, when you look at evolution and you see the different kind of brains, yeah, our brains are more powerful so we can come up with things. And we can see the gradation of different species. So basically, my belief is that the I mean, what you see is what you get. When you get brain damage and you can't think, yeah, that's what's happening. Your brain controls your personality. Yeah.
So your evidence that there's no spirit is what, your evidence is that we have a brain and that the brain's making up everything, mm-hmm. and our brain, different people have different sizes of brains through evolution, and that's your evidence.
Well, see, the evidence, I guess, is what I'm saying is called Occam's razor, too, that the simplest explanation that answers it is good. So, for example, I could say I chose to lift my cup and take a drink. Somebody else could say, like, well, you chose to do that, but it wasn't just you lifting it up. God also assists in lifting up everything, or God actually moves every electron. It's like, well, there's no reason to posit that. You know, we can do that with science now. We can calculate speeds and the planets. You don't have to say God's moving everything.
Well, there is reason to posit it, and the reason is, where did it all come from? Where did the programming come from for it to act in the specific ways that it's acting?
Well, I guess what I'm trying to say is it seems like God's an explanation is superfluous. In other words, you don't need it, so it's just throwing something on there. Like,
well, no, you do need it. You do need it because of the first law of thermodynamics, which says that nothing physical can cause anything new physical. Therefore, there has to be something non-physical to create the initial physical.
That's not the law of thermodynamics. Doesn't say nothing.
It says energy can either be created or destroyed.
Right.
So if energy can't be created, that I'm just doing a subset of that. E equals mc squared. So mm-hmm. mass is a form of energy.
So I had a question about things that go against scientific method or regular things, such as maybe miracles or something that where someone receives their sight or they were lame from birth and can walk. Other things that, you know, more recently where doctors go, there is just no way that should have happened. And they're like, well, we can't explain it. Mm-hmm. So there is no scientific explanation for different things that happen. I considering, you know, especially when people are praying to God and something occurs that the doctors cannot explain. How would that work in your, you know, setting up if there's no extra, you know, supernatural?
Well, see, everything is scientific. Everything you just said is data.
Well, I guess what I'm saying is that there's no God.
Well, okay, so like,
there are things that break the natural law.
Yeah. Well, you know, there may be some healings that are mysterious. Cancer can have spontaneous healings with that's kind of unknown. But you know, consider this. If you know anybody that has diabetes, like in my generation, we can inherit diabetes. Has anybody been cured of that? That type of diabetes that's heritable, that you can't make your insulin? No.
I'm asking things that are proved in hospitals.
I went to a healing service one time, and the preacher called up everybody. He had a feeling, oh yeah, it's people with hemorrhoids. So these people with hemorrhoids come up, he goes, there's more people. And I can believe all these people that came up, because he asked four or five times. There's like 50 people up here. But he didn't call out people with cancer. He didn't call out people with diabetes. But, you know, they'll call out people with headaches and hemorrhoids and, you know.
There's never a person with a missing limb either.
Yeah, that's even more obvious. And I think it's sad because, I mean, when you pray over a quadriplegic or whatever, it's not going to happen, you know. And It's sad, I think, to actually, you know, they feel good about being prayed over, but, you know, if they're a kid and you're praying over them for 30 years, 40 years, pretty soon they say, well, God must not love me because he didn't heal me, you know?
Well, it takes a lot of understanding as to what God's doing here, what's his project here, what his MO is here, and why does he allow, you know, natural disasters, diseases, and things to go in, and there's good reasons for all of that.
Well, we only have time for one more question, so... You already asked a question. Does anybody else want to ask a question that hasn't asked a question yet? Otherwise, we can do a repeat. Okay.
Okay, it seems to me the very best evidence that the soul hasn't been touched. I've been reading Daniel Dennett, a little bit of Steven Pinker. The self, free will, and consciousness. Read Daniel Dennett. If you want a good laughing, howling joke, read Daniel Dennett's attempt to describe the self, or consciousness. That I'm willing to give you biological evolution, but evolution, as far as how it relates to the consciousness, when you read the very top philosophical guys in the field, they are stumbling in the dark so profoundly that it's almost comical. It's back to behaviorism. So look at those questions, because for me, and the last thing is, the reason that perhaps, if string theory is true, the reason that we can't find the soul per se is because we probably exist in many dimensions simultaneously. So there's no reason to think that the soul, or maybe if you don't want to use that term, some more profound part of ourselves doesn't exist simultaneously in another dimension while we exist in this one.
Definitely.
And if it does, there would be no scientific way using your scientific method to refute that.
Well, you know, one thing that the Bible would say about that is Jesus said, they said to Jesus, you know, where's your kingdom? He says, my kingdom is not of this earth. So where would it be? You know, you've talked about multiverses. There is a spiritual kingdom. There is a spiritual, I mean, and that, it takes a lot to get into what all that is. But there is another dimension. It's called the spiritual dimension. And, you know, in the multiverse thing, there could also be heaven and hell. And so it is concurring dimensions, I think, I know for sure the spiritual dimension is another dimension.
Well, not even spiritual, just string theory. String theory is through. True, we're existing in 12 dimensions right now, at least. We're walking through 12 dimensions. So this is only a very small part of our being that you see in front of you.
Well, I think heaven and hell and all that stuff, I mean, that's a whole another ball of wax with all other kind of
things.
I'm
not even talking about
that. Yeah, the multiverse.
I'm just talking about the
but
science.
I would just like to say, as far as consciousness, I agree with you. It's like there's still a lot of developments. But what's really been incredible just in the last, you know, 20, 50 years maybe or something is the neurology, which this is all new information. You know, more, and you know, the knowledge is growing exponentially. You know, like this God helmet they invented to look at religious experiences and things. So anyway, I think we got to end it there because we need to pack up. But you know, usually people hang around if you want to talk some more. And thanks to everybody for being civil. And hope you had a good time.
We have
thank you, speakers.